Let's just start off with like a minute to a minute and a half intro, who you are and what you guys do.
All right, I'll go first. I'm Hart Lamber. I'm one of the co-founders of UMA, which stands for Universal Market Access. The way we really describe ourselves is an infrastructure to build financial products on blockchains, specifically on Ethereum. And what we're starting with is what we call synthetic tokens. So we're infrastructure to create tokens that use the concepts behind synthetic derivatives to create ERC-20 tokens that can track anything with a price feed. And this does fit very much with our name and our mission, Universal Market Access. So we can create universally accessible ERC-20 representations of real-world assets, like, say, the S&P 500 or gold. But we can also create synthetic tokens for kind of anything. And we can probably
like poop.
Talk more about that. Like poop. So I tweeted about this this idea of creating a token that tracks the number of poop sightings reported in the city of San Francisco, which we could do. And our infrastructure will be live on mainnet at the beginning of April, so fairly soon.
Thanks, Hart. It's good to meet this guy. We both live in New York together, but somehow we've never met each other. My name is Mike Lovett. I'm co-founder and CEO of Fluidity and AirSwap. So I've had over a decade of experience in financial technology. I come from classic Wall Street, automated trading, helped build a company called Virtu Financial, which IPO'd in 2015. After that, I caught the Ethereum bug in 2016 by accident meeting Joe Lubin. This is before the DAO happened. The DAO to me was the most fascinating thing, and I realized that when you're algorithmically moving money, similar in Wall Street versus smart contracts, there's just a lot of parallels. Wanted to get involved in the space. And late 2016, early 2017, started to focus around DEX. Decentralized exchanges were really popular on Reddit, which is where all the conversation on Ethereum used to happen. And published a design that put us on the map. We launched AirSwap and have been building it for the past 3 years. Fluidity is the company that built AirSwap, so Fluidity is the company, AirSwap's the DEX, the product. We've also focused on some tokenized securities deals, which created a lot of noise. There was a lot of hype around that space in 2018, 2019. That's kind of dead now, but I think there's hope for that space. And our mission is to empower the world with frictionless trade. I'm glad DEX is succeeding. I'm glad Uniswap has managed to spank basically everyone so that now AirSwap and ZeroX can be friends.
Nice. So, you know, I think it was around 2017 that people started talking a lot about tokenized securities, you know, tokenized the world. There was a lot of speculation that traditional assets would start moving onto to the blockchain. I would call that maybe, you know, 2017, 2018, maybe the ideas phase. People were talking a lot about what was possible. In 2019, I think we saw some issuance deals fall through, but we also saw some, you know, become successful. So I'd call maybe 2019 the issuance phase. And I think we're entering a phase where we're gonna start seeing some meaningful secondary trading of these assets. How would you, let's start with Michael, how would you start, or how would you characterize the current state of the tokenization of traditional assets? It's been kind of a long journey here, one with lots of ups and downs. Where are we at right now?
Yeah, so the evolution of the space is, the way I look at it is there was asset creation, so there was ERC-20. That standardization basically caused the Cambrian explosion of assets being created on Ethereum. With asset creation, you need secondary trading, so you have to have things like Binance and EtherDelta to move those assets. Then we started to replicate the first real-world asset, which was the US dollar, in things like USDC and DAI. I mean, even though when we're talking about tokenizing traditional assets, that's the first asset that traditional asset that's being tokenized right now and is actually kind of hitting scale, which is really cool. And then on top of that, you have asset creation, you have secondary markets, then you have stable coins, and then now you're starting to have borrowing and lending markets. So you're seeing this ecosystem, which is DeFi essentially, which is composability of all these different layers coming together. That itself is going to continue to grow in 2020. People in 2018, 2019 were trying to, I think, jump the gun into a lot of traditional assets like real estate. We managed to close a real estate deal in New York with a regulated broker-dealer. And what we learned in closing that deal is that no one actually cared about the tokenized portion of it. Everyone just cared that it was a good deal that we were bringing to market. Only one person picked tokens out of everyone that actually subscribed to the deal. So this ecosystem just needs a lot more development. The component pieces need to be in place in order for basically traditional Wall Street to pay attention.
Yeah, I mean, I got so much to say on this topic. So I'll start by saying the more controversial thing, which is right now I am not excited about tokenizing traditional assets on the blockchain. And we can go into why that is, but like, okay, some points of differentiation. So there are two real different approaches on how to do this. One I would call like the custodial or kind of custodial stablecoin approach, or where you actually have a legal entity that then issues tokenized representations of that thing. And the other, we'll call it the crypto native or permissionless synthetic approach, where we create synthetic representations. And to go into stablecoins, you've got Maker and DAI, which is a synthetic representation of the US dollar, versus USDC, which is a custodial representation of the US dollar. And first point I'd kind of push on is I think the custodial representations are much less exciting right now. They're not really like a 0-to-1 improvement. They're kind of just a more efficient way of moving securities around the world, around some database. And I think they also like miss out on some of the core kind of ethos that makes Ethereum and blockchain so cool to the early adopters, which is the truly permissionless, truly like unstoppable nature of a pure synthetic permissionless asset or token representation. So okay, that's one point. And the other thing I'd say is that right now the user base today in crypto and in DeFi, they have access to traditional assets in really easy, great ways. And that's because most of these people are in the Western world. Most of them are actually in the US, a lot of the DeFi diehards. And they have the Robinhood account, and they can buy the shit they want to buy. This world would be really different if we had digital assets in the hands of 2 billion people across the world that were like in countries with less well-developed financial services. That totally changes the equation. But that's not the world we're in today. So, you know, we ran an experiment last year where we actually created a synthetic representation of the S&P 500 on the blockchain. And it had $1 million of open interest in it, but it didn't really trade. Nobody really wanted that product. And I think that's just another data point in why it's too early to put traditional assets on the blockchain in any way that gets scale right now.
Interesting. Let's move on to talking about important implementations of this technology. So I think there's a couple categories. One are probably maybe important proof of concepts that kind of prove out that something can work. And I think the second kind of class of important projects are important because they bring traditional institutions, or you know, they bring people into the space or otherwise take it mainstream and are practically useful. What do you both see as important instantiations of ideas around traditional asset tokenization that have actually been executed, you know, on mainnet in the real world?
Well, I think probably one of the catalysts and one of the exciting things that's going to happen in the next 12 months, hopefully, is synthetic assets being included in DeFi. So basically being able to pledge a real asset to a DeFi credit facility. You take, for example, a real estate asset and you can get leverage on it and issue a loan, issue a mortgage. If you can do that at competitive rates to the US system, which we had MakerDAO when prices were falling, we had their interest rates going down to about 3%, which starts to get competitive. Once you can start competing in the interest rate environment, that becomes extremely exciting and I think will be a catalyst for, I mean, Wall Street, even Main Street, people only care about prices at the end of the day. And if you can compete on interest rate, you can refinance mortgages that will be a huge catalyst for the industry. But that requires, you know, obviously the interest rates to be really low. So there's that barrier. And one of the things we did at Fluidity is we released the tokenized asset portfolio, which is a mechanism to represent these real-world assets in the DeFi credit facilities.
I guess quickly, what I think I find most exciting right now as a tokenized real-world asset is like stablecoins. And I do think, I mean, that's the obvious answer and kind of boring, so don't need to talk about it too much. But both DAI and USDC are achieving some scale, like Michael said, and I actually think that's pretty exciting. And it does show, I think it's the guiding light that there is a world where we do have very deep liquidity and real use of real world assets on a blockchain. It's just starting with stablecoins.
Yeah. Interesting. And what about kind of more, I guess, tokenizations of traditional assets? Like I know Harbor recently tokenized $100 million. I believe it's a REIT fund, a real estate fund. Anything else like that that seems interesting, or are those pretty few and far between?
I think the way you should be focusing on the space, if you're trying to focus on tokenization, is to look at the long tail assets. So you look at things that are not highly liquid assets. Like Hart said, if you're trying to compete with the public market equities, you're really not going to provide that much of a value proposition. But if you can look at something like music royalty streams, and you can tokenize something like that, that doesn't have a secondary market. That doesn't have any standardization. It's just this opaque, you know, market that hedge funds trade. And it's actually a really big benefit for music artists or any sort of artists to basically receive all their income up front, and you tokenize the future revenue streams. So I think that is a big opportunity, and you'll start to see that in the next 2 years. Actually, you know, and one of the things that we haven't talked about is Libra. I think Libra is, you know, one of the very good examples of tokenization, where they're tokenizing the U.S. dollar and using that as the core transaction unit of currency for their platform. I'm excited about Libra because even, you know, trust issues aside with Facebook and you know, all the kind of the things that people are worried about, you basically have a top company in the world building a blockchain. And if you just looked at the code they've actually released, it's pretty phenomenal. And the documentation they've actually released, it's pretty phenomenal. And so if you have a platform that has distribution and it has a stablecoin, a tokenized stablecoin as the underlying asset, you can go after a lot more.
Yeah, I think it's probably actually a controversial view in the room, Michael, but I agree that if Libra can get digital assets in the hands of a couple billion more people, that is like huge for our ecosystem and huge for tokenized assets.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, we're building technology for 40,000 people, and it's, you know, it's pretty difficult.
Yeah, we want the billions. To go back to the question, or maybe actually a little off topic, right? I kind of look at the world of assets we can create, synthetic assets we can create, in kind of four categories. And so you've got like stable coins is sort of one special category of a traditional asset that you can tokenize in different ways. I think you have what I'll call the rest of traditional assets, so stocks, bonds, current, like da da da. I think you have like crypto native assets, so maybe that's like a levered version of Bitcoin or short something, like other things that let you speculate on crypto itself. And then to Michael's point, I think you have like the fourth bucket, the catch-all of like other stuff. And it's interesting to think like, where are we gonna get the most traction in the near term? And you know, I think stablecoins, okay, cool, that's working. I think the bucket of other stuff, this long tail, becomes really interesting. And one example that we kind of use is if you think of YouTube as, again, this long tail of user-generated products, you could have never predicted like unboxing videos as being a thing that was gonna become huge. And what I get quite excited about, and what I think is kind of a more natural evolution for the crypto space, is for us to build the infrastructure that lets people create this other stuff, which isn't gonna have a traditional or fiat world like parallel or analogy, but it's going to create the unboxing video of financial products.
It's a democratization of finance.
Yeah, and I think like a lot of like we are lowering the barrier to creating a financial product by like orders of magnitude. And like you said, frictionless trading, right? Frictionless trading, we want to lower the barrier of creating financial products. It fits with the 0x ethos very, very well, right? More things to trade. But like let's get to this world where we can let people invent new stuff and get there as quickly as we can.
Very cool. I hate unboxing videos, people over gesticulating and stuff. Okay, let's move on to talking about the role of exchanges and trading. You know, a couple years ago, T0 and Open Finance talked about some of their plans around creating security token exchanges, but it really seems like a lot of what is important for the tokenization of traditional assets, kind of the controls and permissioning happens primarily kind of at the blockchain level. What do you see as the sort of the outlook for centralized versus decentralized exchange of these assets into the future? Are centralized exchanges really unnecessary, or do you think they have a role?
So the way we look at trade is there are five core components of trade. There is peer discovery, price discovery, execution, clearing, and custody. And the centralized exchange basically centralizes all five of those. A DEX can decentralize all five of those or one of those. Custody, let's just start with that. All DEX decentralize custody. Custody is one of the most regulated and risky things you can do on behalf of someone else. Holding their assets is very risky. So, you know, we think peer-to-peer is a much better suited form for trading because you're not actually taking custody of people's tokens. And actually, you saw the SEC come out and make a statement where they said that with a broker-dealer in ATS, you probably don't want to be taking custody. And so that kind of supported the view that, you know, DEX would have a strong position in the space. But, you know, if you're talking about fiat, if you're talking about incorporating dollars, not in a stablecoin form, you'll have to have a centralized exchange of some sort. But as far as if you have a stablecoin that's widely adopted, for example, USDC or DAI that people are actually willing to use and hold and trade, and it's trading within a band where it's not, you don't have a slippage on the dollar value of it, then you can use a DEX very well.
In my view, the decentralized versus centralized exchange thing is entirely a user experience problem. And I think in this room in particular, and particularly talking to like Michael, this idea of a decentralized exchange makes so much sense. It's like, okay, wait, we're got assets on a blockchain, we can trade them on the blockchain, we don't need a centralized thing at all. And I think like, again, that goes back to why people were inspired by the 0x vision early on, AirSwap, like all this stuff. It's just to the people that think about it, that's the way the world should be. But then you got like people, and people like don't really want to custody their own shit right now. It's kind of scary. And that UX problem and other related things are the reasons why they'd much rather trust Binance, because it's just less scary, or Coinbase. And so I really do think that for the centralized versus decentralized thing, the theory of it won't win. And I think, you know, you look to Asia, why is the Asia consumer going to move to this other platform? It's got to be a better product with a better experience. It's got to be cheaper. And I think those problems will get solved, but they just might take a while.
Interesting. Yeah, I was reading about plans from one security token exchange that they're going to sort of like write all transactions to the blockchain like once a day and charge users gas fees just so that they can sort of check out against various whitelists and permissions and stuff. So I think you made a really interesting point about crypto native assets, Hart, and some of the interesting things that might emerge once we, you know, unlock this liquidity and sort of the ability for really any developer to create a unique financial product. And, you know, I think with a lot of the hype in this space, a lot of it starts with kind of, you know, the institutions are coming and we're going to unlock all trillions of dollars. But often the most interesting inventions come bottom up, and they really start with consumers, and then once it looks like there's something there, they get adopted by maybe institutions start taking notice. What are some of the more interesting, either actual or potential financial products that have emerged or can emerge, given opportunities for permissionless innovations? You talked about the poop token, which I wish would go up in value when there's less poop, because I want to short it.
We can do it that way.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So we talked about, poop token, which I don't know, whatever. It was a fun proof of concept. But what are some other interesting things that you've seen come up that have started to take hold?
I don't think we've seen them quite yet. But we're starting to, I think it's we're still super early stages. I think it's really interesting to think about what are some of the things that people want to trade and speculate on that they can't right now. And it could be something as simple as like let's take stuff that's very, if you just think of DeFi speculators, do people want to bet on a DeFi pulse, on how quickly they think total collateral locked in DeFi is going to grow? Do people want to bet on Bitcoin dominance or altcoin dominance, right? That's currently kind of an uninvestable number. And I think, maybe some of the things start with more tangible kind of DeFi speculative stuff there. Or maybe it starts with bizarro things like this shitcoin that tracks poop tokens or poop sightings in San Francisco. Or, we could do something that tracks subway delays in New York. There's just so much room for experimentation. And I'm quite excited because I think in the next year or two, that's where a lot of this is going to happen. And it's not going to just happen. It's going to happen in a lot of ways. Augur V2 is going to help this happen. I think some of the personal tokens, which aren't exactly financial products, but the personal tokens like Tom Schmidt's meme token that came out, and Ruben's, he's here, he has his council token for advice. These things are also really cool experiments that I'm excited to see play out.
Yeah, personal tokens are cool, and ultimately what you want is you want to solve the demand side of the equation. One of the trends that I keep hearing about right now are quantitative hedge funds that are focused on illiquid assets. And so if you can basically bring illiquid assets onto a standardized format through tokenization or something else, you can attract these types of hedge funds. And then, one of the things that I find really cool is to be able to locally short or take long positions on real estate. Like, for example, if you own a place in, downtown San Francisco and you don't want to sell it, but you want to hedge against the risk of the price going down, you could short that, create a derivative and short that.
I guess I'd add to what Michael's saying, where it's I think the thing that a lot of people in the space sort of forget about, but we remember because of our traditional finance background, for every long, there's got to be a short. So part of building all of these interesting new products means figuring out the mechanism where you can compel both the other side of the market to show up. And arbitrage does this, right? There is a price for anything. But making it really easy and seamless and designing all those mechanisms that make it capital efficient for people to provide liquidity, these are things that aren't quite solved yet. We hope to do a lot of that very soon, but I think it's gonna be really cool to solve these mechanisms, build the designs that compel shorts to show up when there's demand for some synthetic product.
Cool. So just 10-second question. Let's say I wanted to create some kind of token tied to the price of a barrel of oil on UMA. Can I do that right now?
No.
Okay.
2 months.
2 months. Okay, awesome. We've got 40 seconds-ish. We could maybe go over by 30 seconds or so. But what do you both foresee happening in 2020? What do you think we can expect to happen by December 31st of this year?
I think the three most exciting things in the space are just Bitcoin itself. So more and more people actually buying Bitcoin, and this is from traditional investors. On Ethereum, it's the narrative, and rightfully so, is definitely DeFi. I mean, you're seeing a lot of developer activity, a lot of new composability, just random projects popping out of nowhere and getting $10 million locked in DeFi. That stuff is super cool to see and will continue to grow. And the third is Libra.
I think DAOs are really going to be very exciting this year. I think there's a lot going on there. And even I could imagine a correlation of that tied to DeFi, tied to synthetic products, like a DAO to crowdsource new ideas for financial products. That's something somebody suggested to me yesterday. I think it's wild and could be very cool. And I think this long tail of financial products or financial assets, I think this is the year, again, Augur V2, some of what we're doing, there's going to be there's going to be the mechanisms to do some very cool new experimentation. And I think it's going to be wild.
Awesome. Thank you both.
Thank you.